Hello, this is Jitte Wagen, and this is the first video in a series of videos in which I will be introducing ArcGIS 10.7.1. And in this first video, I will be talking about basic steps in ArcGIS, like opening different kinds of GIS data and visualizing this data. Okay, now so for this first video, we will be working with ArcMap, of which you see the interface here. But we cannot really talk about ArcGIS without first explaining a thing or two about the different components that ArcGIS consists of. And now, in contrast to what you may be experienced with, ArcGIS consists of many different software programs that all cover different functions for GIS manipulations that you would want to do. So instead of a program like QGIS, for ArcGIS you see here you have ArcScene, ArcMap, ArcGlobe, ArcCatalog, and a few other things. And these handle, let's say, different parts of the whole GIS project management, data processing, visualization, and analysis. For example, ArcCatalog is a browser program. ArcMap is your general analysis and where in which you do the most workload. ArcScene is optimized for 3D visualization, etc. So it's good to know that you have all these different components installed when you install ArcGIS. And to complicate the matters further, there's now also ArcGIS Pro, which in fact is meant to replace ArcMap at some point in the future. Now this ArcGIS Pro is already here, so you can already buy it and work with it. But this screencast is dedicated to ArcMap because most of the projects that you'll probably be working with will use and are based on an ArcMap environment and ArcMap project file extensions, etc. And there are still functionalities in ArcMap that do not yet work in ArcGIS Pro, whereas ArcGIS Pro is optimized for other types of work and services. So there, in the end, ArcGIS Pro will replace ArcMap, obviously, when it is able to do everything that ArcMap is also doing. But for now, it isn't the case, so it's still a good idea to learn about ArcMap. So let's get back into the program ArcMap, which is the main program of ArcGIS. So we will start with ArcMap by a short tour of the interface. So I will close this window, which is the window that will automatically open when you open ArcMap, in which you can browse for existing maps, or you can open a template or whatever. But I will just cancel this. And now we are in our ArcMap interface. Okay, so what do we have here? Well, the most important part of ArcGIS or ArcMap is the central area, which is the map canvas. So this is the area where all the data that you add to your map will be visualized, and where you can do the main manipulations in case you are editing data or anything of that sort. Well, below the map canvas, you have a couple of buttons that relate to the map canvas. This is the first button is the data view. The second button is the layout view, which is the button that you will use, the mode that you will go into when you are going to make a map or an illustration. Then you have a refresh button. You have a pause drawing button, which is can be interesting in case you have data that takes a lot of time to render and you just want to, for example, do a quick navigation to a place and you know where you want to be, but you don't want all intermediate steps being visualized, which takes a lot of time. And then the final thing here, the lowest area of the interface, you can see here two coordinates, x and y coordinate, that, as you see, display the coordinates of your cursor on the map canvas, and in this case of unknown units because we haven't set any coordinate reference system. Okay, so to the right of your map canvas, I here have an ARC toolbox opened. Now, in case this is not opened on your default installation, you can go to this button in your first toolbar in your menu and click on it, and then the ARC toolbox will open. If you then would click on this little pin over here, which is the auto hide function, it will automatically minimize into your the right bar of your window, your interface, and you can then just click it and it will open. The same goes for the ARC catalog, and these are the two main panels that are, I think, most used in ARC map, because the catalog, well, is functions as a browser through GIS data, and the ARC toolbox holds all the tools that you may want to use. So basically everything that goes on when it comes to the functionality of GIS, ArcGIS, you can find all these tools in the ARC toolbox. Now, if we go back to the ARC catalog, I said this works as a browser. You can see your home, documents, folder connections, toolboxes. So there are also gateways to areas where you may have other toolboxes installed. And then there's things like database servers, database connections, GIS services, etc. So here is also the possibility to connect to online data portals or map servers to bring in data which is stored online into your GIS environment. Now, I will demonstrate this very simply by opening a file through the ARC catalog. Now, I have here home and I have here folder connections. So, ArcGIS works through folder connections. So, you have to establish a connection to a folder where the data or a project or collection of data is where you want to work with. So you cannot just freely browse your computer. You first establish a folder connection and then you work directly with that connection. So you could just see this as a shortcut to a location on your computer or external hard disk. So what I'm going to do is I will make a folder connection to the place on my computer where I have the training data for this these screencasts. Now, if you go to this button, there are a few buttons here which are back, forward, up one level, home, go to default database, choose contents, panel view, etc. So quite basic functions of a browser. But to connect, to create a folder connection, you have to use this little folder image with the plus sign above it. And what I will do is I will go and make a connection to the folder I will be using for this course. And I'll click OK. I'll make this a little bit larger. And then I will click on the plus sign, so it will actually start looking for the data that I have in this folder. And you can see that I have here a database showing the file extension .mdb, so it's a Microsoft Access database. I have here two raster files, which are indicated by these little raster symbols. I have here a shapefile, which is a file storing vector data, and then I have .tab and a .csv file. Now, I will demonstrate the principle of opening data by selecting this ahn3_uitsnede.tif. I will just drag and drop I can drop it on my map canvas or in the table of contents over here. And then I get this this little screen, and I will explain this immediately because it is relevant when working with rasters. So what ArcGIS is now proposing is, it says this raster data source does not have any pyramids or contains insufficient pyramids. Pyramids allow for rapid display at varying resolutions. Would you like to create them? That's the basic question. Now, why is this relevant? In case you have very large raster files, and I will explain raster files in a bit, very large raster files can take a long time to render. And if you're zoomed out a lot, you probably do not need to see all the detail on a raster. So what a pyramid does is actually it creates a resampled version of the raster at a lower resolution that will be used for visualization if you're zoomed out at a certain level. And that basically just speeds up working with rasters and visualizing them. So in general, it's a good idea to build them, unless you you have such an enormous file that even building pyramids is going to take a very long time. So I will just select yes, and there it is. Now this raster turned up here in the map canvas, obviously, but it also turned up in the table of contents. And the table of contents is the area in which your layers are visualized. And that it basically means that every data source that you add to your map will be visualized as a separate layer. And layers allow for changing the order of layers. You can manipulate layers individually. And it basically allows for visually ordering and manipulating your map. So in that sense, it is indeed functions as a table of contents. Now I select this one again, and where what you can see additionally. So this is an elevation model of our research area, and what we can see here is that it has a grayscale color ramp attached to it, which goes from black, the lowest value in the map, so this is meters above sea level, so 7.6, and the highest elevation in the map is 14.75. Okay, and the final thing to mention then is that you could now notice that when I move my cursor over the map, you can see that the coordinates are actually they changed into a known unit, namely the meter. And if I move my cursor, it changes accordingly, correctly coordinates. And these coordinates are in the RD new system. So this is the common projected coordinate reference system used in the Netherlands. And I will come back to this in a few moments. But yeah, this is working, and it's correctly displaying now locations, which means that it can also correctly display measurements of distances and areas, etc. Now to finish off this very quick tour of the interface, just a final word on the table of contents, which has different visualization modes. So we now are in the mode list by drawing order. So now we actually have here a layer order, and the files are listed by the order of their drawing. Now we can also select here for a visualization by source, and then you can see that it actually points here as the main entry into the table of contents to the location where our data source is located. And we can also list by visibility, which could, for example, mean that if you would have layers turned off, they will not be visible in the table of contents, which can be very useful if you have a project with a lot of layers and you do want to very quickly browse through the layers that you are actually using. And then you can also list by selection, so you have only layers visible in your table of contents that you selected in your map canvas or through any other means. So yeah, these are the various visualization modes, but this is the most useful one, or at least the one I use the most. And then finally here at the top we have two toolbars with a navigation toolbar with selection options and some simple editing tools or inquiry tools, I should say. So find, measure, XY coordinates, etc. Here we have basic file and project menus, add data, scale of the current map. So we are now looking at this this data in scale 1 to 3507. Yeah, and I already mentioned these buttons through which you can open and close various parts of the various panels. And then finally, of course, we have here the menu through which, in some way, all the options are available. Now, I will not go through all these functions in the menu individually because we will see them in the course of these introductory videos. Okay, so now I want to start this first video of this introduction with showing how you can open various file types in ArcMap. I just showed how you can open a raster file. Here you can see something which I refer to as a vector file. And maybe this is a good moment to very briefly explain the difference between common GIS file types, at least the difference between the two most common ones, which are raster and vector. Okay, so let's start with the raster file. Now, a raster that you can see here in the map is basically a raster, so a matrix of cells, all equally sized square cells that have a fixed surface area, and all these cells can contain a value. Now, you have every raster has a number of bands. You can have one band, or you can have three bands, or multiple bands, and this determines the information depth a raster can actually store. Now, in this case, you can see a so-called single band raster. So every cell here, and we can see the actual cells. If we zoom in, you can see them. So here you can see that actually all this data consists of very small cells containing a unique value. Or not necessarily unique, but a single value. And these values here are elevation values. Now, an example of a multi-band raster could be, for example, if you would have in one single cell, three bands, every band storing R, G, or B. So you would have a red, green, or blue value. And that would compose then an RGB color code, and that would be typical for something like an aerial photograph or something. So that is how raster basically works. Okay, so vector data on the other hand, and I will open this little file over here for verharding.shp, and shp stands for shapefile. I just said it earlier, which is the Esri, the creator of ArcGIS, developed file for storing vector data. And I will show how that looks so you can get a good impression of the difference. So vector data actually consists of geometrical descriptions. So what it is, and you can see it a bit better if you zoom in, vector data consists of individual geometrical definitions. You can have three types of vector data. So vector can be just points, and in that case you would have coordinates. If you would connect these coordinates with lines, you would have a polyline vector file. And if you have have polylines that come back at their origin, and in that sense create an area, so enclose an area, you have a polygon vector file. Okay, so when do you use vector data? Vector data, as you can see, is very precise. Actually, the because it is defined by a geometrical description of vectors, the lines do not have an area as opposed to the smallest element of a raster, which is a cell that has an area. So that means that vector is best used for describing spatial data that is discrete, so that has a very strict boundary. In this case, boundaries are between roads and non-roads, and parts which are highway and which are not highway. For this type of data, buildings or borders between things, roughly said, vector data is optimal. On the other hand, it is not very effective when you want to describe something like elevation that can change continuously on a very local level. So on a very small area, you have many different changes in the actual elevation value, and that would become very encumbered to describe using vector data. And then raster is very efficient to describe such a continuously, gradually changing spatial information value. And so another way to say it is that that vector data is optimized indeed for discrete data, and raster data is optimized for continuous data. Okay, so we are now heading to the other files in this folder, and the next file we see here is zv13_ASCII_SporArt.tab. Now, a TAB file, a TAB file, is a file format which is native to another GIS software package, which is called MapInfo. In ArcGIS, on the contrary to a program like QGIS, a .tab file is not immediately recognized as storing vector data. And you can see that the icon indeed here is a sheet of paper instead of the vector data symbol. And it's also impossible to just open it. Well, you can open it, but it will not be displayed as vector data. The vector information will not be recognized and visualized. So it's now just displaying that you added something to the map, which is interpreted as a table. And nothing else in the source is indicated, but it won't show up as a layer, so, as you can see. So I will just remove it. Okay, now this file type is actually a very common file type in the Dutch archaeological commercial sector in the Netherlands. So it's interesting to see how you can work with these files. But unfortunately, ArcGIS does not really offer any easy tools for doing this. If you would, for example, open the ArcToolbox and go to data management tools, conversion tools, you can see here, for example, a tool that will convert a feature class to shapefile, but in the you cannot input any features that are of the type .tab. Now, a tool in ArcGIS with which you could do this is the data interoperability tool, but that costs more money. So you are here in this very weird situation, actually, where you have a very expensive extensive GIS software, but you are not able with the default tools and default options to import another very common GIS file type. So we have to get out of ArcGIS to actually be able to do this very simple thing. Now there are various ways you can do this. One of them would be to actually go to QGIS. You can download that for free, which is a free open source software. And you can very easily open a TAB file and save it as a shapefile. And I show this in my screencast on the in which I introduce QGIS. You can, another way to do this is to, if you have a copy of map info, you can use map info to, it has a tool called the universal translator, and you can use that to translate your TAB file into a shapefile. But I'll show you here a third option, which is using the OGR tool. Now, OGR stands for OpenGIS Simple Features Reference Implementation, and it's a set of tools with which you can, amongst other things, easily convert between file formats. Now, if you would open a browser and you would go to, you would type in OGR to GUI, and you hit the download option, you go to the SourceForge location. We download the package. It will start downloading. We'll open it. Yes. And I will place this actually into the folder with the training data which I've been working so far. Yep, there it is. Then I will use the .exe, and then I will come into this neat little program. And in this program, I can select file. I want the format to be the map info file. I can then select which file I want to work with. So let's go again to the right location. Now we have here the file filter on mapinfo.tab file. So now I can select this file. Does not recognize the projection. I will come back to that in a minute. It queries the file, well, it's not really of any importance. File, then it will convert it into an ESRI shapefile. I will save it on a location and we'll call it spore art, which means feature type or feature interpretation. And then finally, we select the projection. And what you see here is a list of projections with a number for it, and the number actually refers to the EPSG, so the European Petroleum Search Group, which is simply a group that created an index for projection types, because there are so incredibly many projection systems. So this is to just make it easier creating an index for them, and we'll have to go to the number 2899. Let's see, where is it? 28992, and that's actually the RD new, so the Rijksdriehoekstelsel new system that I was talking about earlier. So we select that, we do execute, and we quit. And now, if I go to my catalog, I go to the connected folder. I hit function 5 button on my keyboard. I refresh, and then indeed I see I now have here a shapefile called SporeArt with the .shp extension, and now we can use it in ArcMap. Okay, so in order to use it, I will again just drag and drop to the layers panel. Now I get an interesting message. So it says unknown spatial reference. The following data sources you edit are missing spatial reference information. The data can be drawn in ArcMap but cannot be projected. Now, this is a very subtle difference. Or at least it is in this case, as you may have noticed. you can see here vector data appeared on the map, which are actually archaeological trial trenches that have been dug in this these few fields. But what it means is that ArcGIS doesn't understand in what projection this data has been set up. And it will just look at the coordinates stored in the vector. So all these vectors have are tying vertices together, these points, and these points have coordinates, and it now just throws the coordinates on the location in the current coordinate reference system we are working in. And because they are all recorded in the same coordinate reference system, we see them on the right location. But if we would have different reference systems for our data, this would not have happened. So that's a subtle difference, and I will go into it in more detail in a few seconds. But for now, let's say we accept it, and we see that that we now have our data indeed in place, and this fits quite neatly with the topography and the elevation data indicating our various fields. So we can see that this this must be right. However, it is better to avoid this and to attribute a projection system, a coordinate reference system, before you add it to your map. So I will first explain a few little things about projection systems, and then I will show you how you can avoid this this message. Okay, so first of all, then very quickly, so what is a coordinate reference system? A coordinate reference system consists of two parts, of which the first is a datum, and the second is the projection. A datum is an approach to attributing coordinates to a location on a globe. So, of course, the Earth's surface is an ellipsoid, so it's irregularly shaped. It's not even a perfect sphere. So you need to have a system to point to locations on that on the globe, and we have various systems for that, and they vary in approximations of the exact shape of the globe, and etc. etc. But in any case, this is the typical location, which has a latitude and a longitude. And then the second part is the projection. So these are all 3D locations, and we want to have them projected onto a 2D map, because in the end, our GIS environment is a two-dimensional map. We have a paper maps, of course, are also 2D. So we are used to work within GIS in a Cartesian system of an X and a Y axis. And that, of course, allows us to do all the Euclidean Cartesian geometry. Now, if we do not have that, we are going to run into troubles with a lot of the basic type of geometrical calculations that we want to do. Now, a projection is thus the translation between 3D coordinates to 2D coordinates. And if you translate 3D to 2D, with points from a globe onto a flat projection plane, there's always going to be distortion in some way. So you can never do this projection respecting both exact locations, exact angles, and exact surface areas. Now, because we have these variations of datums and we have these variations on projections, and these projections are all optimized to do one or more things very good at the expense of another one, or on average everything as best as possible, there's an enormous number of coordinate reference systems out there which are optimized for geographical locations or purposes or what have you. So that's why it matters what projection your data is in, and therefore you need to know a little bit about them. And it is good to have this all sorted out very well for the project you're working on. Now, what we saw happening here with this shapefile we created from the .tab file, it didn't No, it's projection, although we set it in the OGR tool, so this is probably because it just doesn't know its original projection. I'm not entirely sure. I don't know the OGR tool that well. But in any case, it's simple to solve. What happened here is we see that our data appeared on the right location. So ArcMap was able to draw it on the right location, which means it has the correct coordinates. The only thing ArcMap doesn't know is the bit in which for GIS data file you actually define, so this data is projected into this or that kind of coordinate system. And you can imagine that in the end, all these different datums and projection systems make use of similar number ranges. So you can imagine that this number range in another data set can be on an entirely different location, and then things are starting to get into, you're starting to get into trouble. Now, if you have this projection defined, and if you would be working in another coordinate reference system, then ArcGIS can on the fly reproject. So it says, okay, so I see your data now are in RDNew, but you are working in a universal transverse Mercator projection, for example. I can on the fly reproject, and then they will still appear on the right location. So this is why it's important to have this all in order. And I will now show you how you can very simply define the correct coordinate reference system for this this shapefile. In order to do this, we go to the Arc Toolbox. Here we go to the Data Management Tools. Here we have an option Projections and Transformations. And here we can select Define Projection. Okay, just as an interesting thing to know about the toolbox, so I have here the tool, I will just close it because I want to show you one thing. You have all these tools here. If you single click on a tool, you will open it for a single process. If you right click, you can actually select Batch, and then you can actually input more files, input the variables for the processes that you want to do with them, and then you can hit OK, and then you will, all these files will be batched processed, so you don't have to open and close the tool for every individual conversion in this case that you, or the defined projection that you would want to make. So this is just an useful little bit of extra information. Now let's go back to the matter at hand. This is our defined projection. I will select Spore Arc because that's actually the file that I want to define its projection for. Coordinate system unknown. Well, that's something we already were well aware of. And now, so here we come into the spatial reference properties. There's a difference between geographic coordinate reference systems and projected. I will leave that for now. We can go and search, and then we would go for national grids, and then just go down. Where is it? But indeed, we can browse for the grid, which is basically what I wanted to say. You can also access, just open layers, and you will get all the available coordinate reference systems that are now in your layers. Or the other thing you could do is just type in this EPSG number and then hit the search button, and then you will also find it here in National Grids Europe RDNew. So these are the same, of course, just another way of finding them. So select one of them, click OK, RDNew, and then we click OK again. Now, takes a bit of time, and here it is. Okay, and if such a conversion went well, you can see here this small panel popping up, or window, saying defined projection, and you see the green success sign over here, so you know that everything went okay. If there's a red cross here, you know that you're it did not go well, and you have to find out why. Okay, so now we have the projection defined. And I can now demonstrate this again by removing this shapefile, opening the catalog. I will hit refresh, so function 5 just to be sure, and I will edit again. And now this question is not asked anymore because the projection is known. Another way to inspect the projection of your file is to go right click on the file in the catalog, select its properties, go to XY coordinate systems, and here we can see the GCS Amersfoort, which is indeed the RD new, which is correctly set for this file, RD new, and again the PSG. So this is how you can work with defining a projection system, inspecting whether there are projection systems, which they are, and how you can work with that. Okay, so there's one more useful thing to know about coordinate reference systems in ArcGIS, because we so now we've been talking about a coordinate reference system, which is part of the definition of the data in this file. But in ArcGIS, the coordinate reference system is defined on the level of the data frame as well. So we see here this table of contents entry, which is called layers. But actually in ArcGIS, this is called a data frame. And you can add multiple data frames to a single map, and that can be very useful for various reasons. But the important thing for now to know is that the coordinate reference system is defined on this level, if you want. So you can go to the properties, the data frame properties, and here we could change the coordinate reference system for this map. So by default, it takes on the reference system of the first layer you add to this data frame, but you can change this, and then it will reproject, as it is called, on the fly, all the data in the data frame on into a different coordinate reference system, which can be useful, of course, if you make a map, for example, for a client or a colleague who works with a different reference system and needs that for some reason. So it's good to know that you can do it over here. And so then the implied information also is that there can be a difference between the coordinate reference systems of the layers you add and that of the data frame. Just remember that if this difference is there, data will take more time to draw because everything has to be reprojected on the fly. So if you do not want that, just make sure that your coordinate reference system of your data frame and your layers is always the same. Okay, so up to this point about coordinate reference systems in ArcGIS, what I want to do now to finish this part on importing data, I want to go and explain how to import another file type, which is a list of coordinates. So in archaeology, there are many reasons why you would have a coordinate list, because it's a standard export from tools like total station measurement systems, GPS measurement systems, and other tools that we may use. And the typical output is a text-based file in which you will simply have an x-coordinate, y-coordinate, and some maybe some reference information. So it's very important to know how you can import this data and project it on the right location on your map. Now, just before doing so, what is this for type of file? What does it look like? We see here that the file has the file extension .csv. CSV stands for comma separated value. And if we would go into our Windows Explorer and open the file, We can see that this is a CSV file. It is currently associated with Microsoft Excel, but we can just open it in a text editor, and then we can see the two main things to see is that we see one line with terms, which are actually the names of the columns which are built into the structure of this file. So the first value we have here says trench put, which means trench, comma pluck, which would mean layer, comma type, comma etc. Now this is the name of the columns of data in this file. If we then look to the second row over here, we can see that we have the value 1 between quotes, then we have our double quotes, then we have a comma, then we have again 1, so that means that these commas are delineating the columns just as they are here. So what we could now understand is that we have here a column which refers to trench numbers, and this the first record stores trench number 1, then we have a second column with layer, comma, and then that value attached to that in the first record, actual record is 1, and so on and so forth. So these are comma separated values, and the first line over here holds the column names. So in a way, although this looks a little bit messy, this is systematically stored data, because there is a column, there's a table structure built into this file, and it's simply done by using these commas. Now, if we go back into ArcGIS, and we would double click on this file, we can see that it opens directly into Excel through its file association with Excel. And there's another way we could already explore the contents, and that is by dragging it into our project, because we can always drag a table into our project. If we do this, we see that the table of contents view changes again from the actual drawing order to the source listing. And if we would now open this, we can see that the data is now displayed in an orderly set of columns, because this is how ArcGIS can already interpret the commas in the comma separated file. So now you can see that it's indeed properly organized, but still this is a flat table, and although we have X and Y coordinates, there's no use of these coordinates. We are not projecting them on the map using these coordinates. These are just values in a flat table. So how can we go about this? I will remove it, because in fact we do not necessarily need it here. I want to show another function. And this function we can find over here in the file menu. Here are various options, of which this one is important. We can go for add data. Now you can see here, this is interesting in any case. We can always use this function instead of the ArcCatalog to add any data sources. But if we would go to the fourth option, add XY data, we can now specify a comma separated file. So if we would do that, I'll open. I have already been browsing to this map, so I will select the comma separated file, add. I can now define X, Y, and Z field if they are here. So I have to be careful now, because what I want is the X coordinate and the Y coordinate, and the Z field I leave to none, because we do not have any Z information. Now, again, we have to set the correct coordinate reference system, which is already what it should be. If it wasn't, we could change this through this edit button, and then we can just hit OK, and then the data, this is the message we now see, is somewhat important, but for now we'll ignore it, because we're going to solve this issue anyway. And if I click OK, you see that ArcGIS created a layer which is called filename.csv space events. So it now created an event layer, and this layer indeed holds our points. So all these individual dots now are the HY coordinates translated to locations, displayed as points, objects on our map. And if we would click on them, we can see that we have all the data from the CSV file already attached to them. So we have here the range and the layer and the type, etc., etc. Now, in order to be able to work with this this data in a way that we would be able to work with geometry stored in a shapefile, I will actually turn it into a shapefile, because now it's just a layer that is created in ArcGIS but has no, let's say, physical file on the on my computer. I see here that it is a geometry type point already, so this indicates geometry type, but it's not yet a shapefile. So in order to do that, I will right click on the layer, I will go to data, export data. What I want to export is this layer source data, and then I will click browse, and I will select here, I can go for a geodatabase. A geodatabase is a proprietary database system that, or file type, I should say, that ArcGIS offers for use. But I personally prefer working with individual shape files most of the time. So I will just create this shape file, and I will call this finds and save. Click OK, and then I want to export it to the map, and then I have two layers, so this is an exact copy, but now it's a full shapefile, and I will just remove now this events layer. And so, yeah, there we are. Okay, so on to the next thing. You've seen me using navigation through the map a couple of times, so I will now explicitly deal with how you can do that. Well, first of all, you can use the mouse scroll wheel to zoom in and out. And you can also pan through your map by pushing down the mouse button and dragging the map in various directions. So that's an easy way to navigate your data. Of course, there's also menu options for this. You have here zoom in and zoom out, and these work by either clicking on the map or drawing rectangles. Also, you have here the fan, so you can just activate the tool, and then you just use left mouse button. And another thing you can do here is zoom to full extent. And the full extent means that you zoom out to the maximum extent of the layer with the largest extent. Now then, next to this, you have fixed zoom in and fixed zoom out. And something which can be very useful is go back to previous. So this is kind of an undo button, but then for your navigation. And then finally, a function that I use a lot is by, if you right click on a layer and you click then on the fifth option, zoom to layer, then you automatically zoom to the extent of that specific layer. And that can be very useful, certainly if you have a lot of data and cover a large geographic extent, but maybe layers can just cover a very specific set or subset of data, then the zoom to layer file is really your friend if you want to quickly navigate to the right layer extent. Okay, so this is just a few words on navigating through the app canvas. Okay, so in the meantime, we now have here four layers in our layers panel. And I just want to say a few things about your layers panel. Of which the most important is, as I said, this is a table of contents as to the data which is projected in your map canvas. And an important thing to know about this is that the order of the layers in your table of contents over here actually determines the order of the data in your map. So if I would, for example, drag the layer storing the feature interpretation, so the score art, under the AHN file, they disappear because they are literally projected below the raster file that stores the elevation data. So if I would turn it off, I see my data again. But if I turn it on, it will, let's say, sit in between spore art and verharding and fine. So we see the fines and the verharding, but we do not see the spore art. So the most important thing to take away from the simple system is that the order indeed in your table of contents directly corresponds with the order in your map. Now, furthermore, as you just saw me doing, you can turn on and off individual layers. And you can set the properties of individual layers, so you can set things like transparency, etc. Things we'll come back to later in this series of videos. Okay, so with this, I want to end with the first part of this first video, in which we've been looking at the importing different kinds of data, the role of coordinate reference systems, different data types, and how to navigate through your data and use the layers panel to change the order of the data. And now we'll go on to the second part of this introductory first video, in which I will be showing how to start asking simple questions to your data. Okay, so the most straightforward tool to make queries onto your data is to use the identify tool, which you just seen me using also to pick up these the information on a single point. So in order to demonstrate, I will go to this little area, and I will click on this feature over here. Now what happens is that we get this result. So we get the identify an identify panel, and we can see here that I want my identify information to come from the topmost layer that I hit. So not the topmost layer in our table of contents, but the first layer that I'm actually clicking on, the first layer which has the highest position in our table of contents. So if I click on this, I can see that I selected something, or I required an identify from something in the layer spore art, and I actually clicked on two polygons at the same time. So I see this, I have selected two times something which is called spore, and I see the location and all the attached information to this polygon directly visualized. Now, if I would, for example, select visible layers, and I would click on the this location, I would also immediately get the information from the AHN 3, so the LiDAR data that I just added to my map canvas, and I indeed see that I get the local elevation value. So I clicked on a specific cell, and it gave me the altitude information stored in that cell. So in this way, and then you have selectable layers and all layers, you can play a little bit with the information that you get from clicking on the map with the identify tool. Okay, so I just need to mention that for those of you who have some experience with GIS, this is a little bit atypical data, in the sense that, as you can see, I click on this layer. This is a single layer with polygon data, and if I click on it, I get a result of two different geometrical entities. And so what's actually going on here is that there's polygons in this file that are overlapping, and we can easily see that if I would double click, I will come back of course to this visualization later more extensively, but if I will do it quickly now, double click on the symbol of the visualization, I will click on hollow, and you can see that indeed I have here two overlapping polygons. So there's the center of that feature, and there's the direct surrounding of that feature. Now this is atypical because, well, it's a general best practice requires that you do not store overlapping polygons in a single layer, and I won't go into that in detail. I will just mention it because it may be a bit strange if you see this and you have some GIS experience and know that this is not typical, but in this project there are good reasons to have this in this way, but just so you know. So I mentioned already that what we see here is actually data that is stored in the attribute table, and so you're probably wondering, what is this attribute table now? The attribute table is a table that is directly connected, stored within your file, so within your data source. And in this table, every single, when it comes to vector data, of course, every single geometrical entity has a record attached to it with information directly relating to that a geometrical entity, so with descriptions in this case of the archaeological features. It can also be additional information about who did the survey, field survey of these individual finds that we entered into our map canvas, etc., etc. Okay, now in order to open this attribute table, we right click on one of our layers and we select open attribute table, and then we are confronted with this little window in which we indeed see the a layer at the connected attribute table with all the information stored which are connected with our geometrical entities. So what we see here is indeed feature ID, shape, flock type, etc., which is of course exactly the same as here, which is of course because this is exactly the same data. So this is how you conjure up the attribute table. Now, as you may imagine, making selections in the attribute table is similar to making selections on the map. So if I would close this little identify window, I would first close the attribute table and give back my spore art layer something of a color so we can see them better when zoomed out. So let's zoom out a bit, overseeing the complete research area. So if I would now open the attribute table and I will just randomly select the first or 30 or so entries, and I will look at my map. I can see, and you see that the ArcGIS default selection color is this greenish color. You can see that the items that I selected through the attribute table are also directly selected in the map. Now the next thing is to understand that this is of course also working vice versa. So if I would select here the clear selection tool, I would go to this tool, which is a select features tool that you can use in the map canvas, and I will draw a rectangle. Now my features are selected in the map, and I can see that they are also now selected in the table. So in this way you can choose what's more easy to approach selection, whether you want a spatial selection or whether you want to select them based on information in the attribute table. You can go about it either way. Okay, so the attribute table has its own set of functions over here. So I will go through them and explain what you can do with them. So what we see here in the lower end of the screen is we see a navigation tool, so we can here navigate through the records, and you see the little arrow moving. We can select for show all records or only show the selected records, which can of course be useful to have a concise set of records about which you are currently on which you are currently interested to work with. And you see here how many of the records are actually selected. Now we can here well, there are some tools which we can use here, which is select by attributes, switch selection, which of course was the inverse of the selection that we had, and we can clear selection, and we can select zoom to select. So if we would select our data based on the values in the attribute table, for some reason we want to select all features with the interpretation of slow, so a water filled ditch in the columns 4 art, we can make that selection, and then we would zoom to select it to see where these features are actually located. Now I consciously avoided the first one because this is the most extensive one, and if we left click here we can see that we have a range of options. Find and replace, so this would be when we would be editing the data in the attribute table. This is a topic I will come back to later. We can here do indeed the same, select by attributes, clear, switch, and select all. We can add fields, again relevant when editing or adding this in this case data to our attribute table. And then there are some more options that are a bit more advanced, not really part of this introduction. But there is one specific function here that I want to dig a little bit deeper into, which is select by attributes. Okay, and if I so if I open select by attributes, what I'm basically allowed to do is to create an expression using the attributes to create a selection. So how does this work? What we're basically looking at is a graphical tool through which we can make an SQL statement, so a structured query language statement, which is indeed already given away here. Enter a where clause to select record table window. So what we are doing is we are going to complete actually this SQL syntax. So select all from spore art, which is of course the attribute table's origin, where, and then we can here enter a selection criteria. We are helped with this. Let's say we would want to select all waterfield dishes. So this is in Dutch sloot. So this is an entry into the column spore art. So if we want to use that as a where clause, we go to spore art, double click on it, and you can see that it will be added in double quotes because it's text to the formula over here. And then we can select an operator. So we can say equals or is not or is like, greater than, etc., etc. So there are various operators here that we can use, but we want to have an equals at this moment. And then we could just enter slot into the where clause, but we can also ask for the unique value. So then what will happen is it will actually do a query on the column, and it will give us a list of all unique values. So if I click on it, I see here all the different interpretations, and then I will close, double click on it, and then I could verify to see if the at least the syntax of my expression is correct. So of course it will not tell us if the intended selection will actually show up, because that depends on if we correctly defined everything and use the right terms. This is just saying this syntax is a valid syntax, and it won't give any error messages. So if we do that and then hit apply, we can see that indeed all the entries in the records in the attribute table that have slowed in 4 are selected. And if I close this and we would zoom out a little bit, we can see that indeed in all these different excavation trial trenches, we can see that elements are selected that apparently are understood to be part of ancient waterfield ditches. Okay. Okay, and then the final thing to very useful tool when it comes to the attribute table, and I will just now clear this selection, is that we can also systematically work, or I should say, work with expressions on the values of the different columns, in the sense that we can edit them in that way. So to do that, we have here a tool. If we right click on the column header, which is called the field calculator, if I click on that, it will say, well, we are outside of an edit session. I will come back to edit sessions later in this series of videos. It means that in any way, just very quickly, if you want to change data, whether it is the geometrical definitions or whether you want to change data in the attribute table, you do this typically in an edit session, which you can start and stop, etc. What RGS is now telling us is that we are now, we didn't start any edit session. We can do this, we can do a calculation on this field, but then there's no way to undo the results, so the edits will not be saved in immediate stages. So there's no undo option if we will do this. At this moment it doesn't matter because I just show the tool itself, and this is it, this field calculator. And what we can do here, what this allows us to do, is say, well, I have here 4 art, and I want, let's say we had a selection, and I want the all these 4 art, which that is now interpreted as slowed, as waterfield ditch, but I want to change the attribute table's value into, let's say, remains of a waterfield ditch, or believed to be a waterfield ditch, or whatever, or slowed question mark. So we can use this tool to create an expression that will edit all the information in one column in one single operation. So that's very useful, and we'll be using that in the very near. Okay, so before turning to the final part of this introductory first screencast on ArcGIS, I want to show you how you can create a subset of data by creating a selection of data based on value in the attribute table, or more values in the attribute table, and save the selection as a new shapefile. So you have a separate layer with its own source data, which is a subset of your original data file. So in order to do this, I will select again on attributes, and I will now show how you can also, for example, access this using the selection tool in the through the menu. So here we can go to the attributes. We go into the same field as you've seen before. And what I actually want to do, and just to illustrate, I open the attribute table again. What I want to do, I want to select basically the first layer of archaeological features that is visible after first opening the any trial trench that we have in our project. So if the trial trench is being dug, then the topsoil is removed, and the topsoil and layers underneath are removed systematically until the first archaeological features turn up, and this is typically called layer 1 or flock 1 in Dutch. And what I want for this project is I want to select for all trenches, this flak one for to work with. So I want to create my sub-selection based on that information. Okay, so now let's do this. Okay, so now let's do this. I will bring my select by attributes window forwards. What I want to show is that you can also just type in the where clause. So I will have here now pluck and think about the quotation. So we have a quote here. And I will enter one here. So why do I not use the single quotes? If we look into the attribute table, I can see that the outlining of the information is here to the right, whereas in case we have text, it is outlined to the left. And this is an indication that we have different data types here. So we have a numeric data type for this field, and we have text data type for the other. And when it comes to numeric values, you do not need any quotes, and the quotes are there to make clear that we are talking about text entry. So this is why we don't need these single quotes. And then another thing which is important, of course, is to select the right layer. So to avoid that, we just select finds. I want to use 4 RTL. I have to re-enter the query actually and see when I change the layer. So I will do that. I will verify it's okay. I will hit OK. And then we have indeed everything selected on layer 1, which should be evident from the attribute table. If I scroll down and hopefully also see some features which are on layer 2 and therefore are not selected. They are over here. So you can see here that indeed, as it should be, it only selected everything with value 1 in the column flux and not with other values. Okay, now to show some further functionality of this selection tools. If I want to add a criterion for selection, so I will go back to select by attributes. Here we can see that the selection is still there, the flak 1. Let's say I also want to filter on the trench number, so I just want to see features from at a layer 1 from trench number 1. So a way to do it is I could say, well, instead of now making a new selection because I already have a useful selection, I want to, for example, select from current selection. So that means that my next selection query will only query the current selection. So if I now will ask for trench 1, I will select all features belonging trench 1 from this selection, and then we already set that selection to be layer 1, so then I have indeed what I want. Other options here are remove from current selection or add to current selection. That speaks quite for itself. So if I would say select from current selection, I can change flak to put and I would apply. I can now see, and in this is a typical situation which zoom to layer can be very useful. Zoom to layer. Zoom to selection, of course, which is also available here. So right click on the layer, selection, and then zoom to selected features. That was the one I was looking for. And now you see that indeed we have this selected. And if we look at it in the in the attribute table, we can see that we have indeed only trench 1 and layer 1. And just to be complete, another way to go about it would be to go back here, and instead of select from a current selection, we can just make a new selection and we can use an operator. So we could work like this. which is again basic SQL, a basic SQL operator. So what we're now saying is I want to select all records from SporArt where the value in the trench, in the column trench is one, and so we add a criteria, we want the value in the column clock to be one as well, and then we will have, I will apply, you will see nothing changed, but it is because we get exactly the same result. And so you can get also use the other operators like and or and not, etc. So these are ways to create sub-selections, but actually I want to go back to my original one and select everything at layer one. So as I said, I wanted to show how to save this selection into a new shapefile. So now I have this selection, I can right click on the layer to which I belong. I can go to data, select export data, and now what is directly set is selected features. So not select all features or all features in view extent, but has its own functionality of course, but it's now, because we have a active selection, it's now set to select features based on the assumption that that is what we want. And then we can set the location. So again, we are here in the folder with our GIS data in which we are working, and I will call these SporArt, and I will say layer one and hit save. Okay, it exported. It immediately asked us if we want to add it to the map as a new layer. Say yes, and there we have it. So now we can we have just this layer with the selection, based on the selection that we just made, which is a sub-selection of the data from SporArt. So in the final part of this screencast, I want to talk about how to visualize data in your layers in various ways. And what I want to do is I want to use the SporArt underscore layer underscore one shapefile to show how you can attribute colors to the different categories of interpretation as they are stored in the attribute table of the layer. As a categorical visualization of information. Then I want to show how you can do a visualization based on continuous data. So I want to use the elevation data from our AHN LiDAR file to show you how you can set a color ramp that then represents the graduational change in elevation values in the raster file. And then finally I want to use the vector file with the point information to show you how you can set labels for your entities on your map. Okay, then to start with the visualization of the categorical data from our polygon shapefile. Now, right-click properties, we get into this window with a whole range of different tabs in which we can adjust visualization, look at information, set labels, joints, etc. But for now, the most important tab here is the symbology tab. Well, I already showed a very quick way to come to the symbol selector. So this would be a very quick way in which you could work with the visualization of your layers. But if you want to do some more complicated things, then you will need to use the symbology tab. So the most important thing here to understand is that we can here actually determine what data level we are actually want to use. So if we are just on the level of features, we can just select one symbol only, because all the features will be visualized in the same way. But now we want to go for categories. So we can actually select a field from the attribute table and use the information for that from that field to create categories. Now, just to be complete, what we also can do is go for quantities, and then we can use some numerical value and create classes of information based on the histogram that is based on the frequencies of this numerical information. It could be interesting if you would have numbers representing shared densities or whatever in fields or features. And then there are some other options like charts and multiple attributes that go beyond the scope of these this introduction. But we will now stay with categories, unique values, and we were talking about the interpretation. So we select score art. Here we can see the color ramp combo box. We can select here from a whole range of predefined color ramps. Now let's select one of them just to show how this works. We see here now only in our screen that will give us our legend, so that will display our classification actually. There's nothing here except just all other features. So if we want to have features from the value fields for art, we just click on add all values. And now you can see that we have here all the values. We can see the value itself. We can see the label it will have. And this we can change. Whereas, of course, the value from the table we cannot change. Here we can change the label of the values that will be used in the agenda. And here we see the count, so we can see how often specific feature types have been or feature interpretations have been encountered. But if we just leave it at this default, and of course these are a few, that these colors are a bit too much alike to provide a really good visual classification information. But in any case, just to demonstrate the principle, I will accept them and I will click OK. And now we can see that indeed, based on the four eyes of the interpretation, colors are being attributed to polygons, and we can see here, for example, that the butterfield dish indeed is now a brownish color. Now, in addition, it is interesting to know that you can tweak a lot. If we see here that we have all other values count zero. We can just turn them off if there would be a count, for example, because you have an empty field or, oh no, that's not true, by the way, that would be this one. But if you have other values that are somehow not part of this classification, you can give them a color, but you can also just switch them off. We have the category niet benoemd, so these are empty fields. And we can, for example, double click on them and make them hollow if we would want. So we can have them displayed with a color to make clear that we have no information on them. And now what's more to say, and you just saw me do it, you can change the individual color. So there's a lot to adjust here. So you can select preset colors, you can here. Or you can select preset field types, and then you can here select the field colors. Part of these presets, not only field types, of course, but also outlines. You can change outline colors, the outline width. We can edit the symbol and go into a lot of detail about how we want to look like. This is just a matter of your own creativity. Now, I already showed that there are a lot of color ramps that you can work with. What you can also do is we can go to the properties of a color ramp, and we can manipulate these different values to change it. So if we just change the values of the color ramp, we change things like saturation, values, and the use, and you can see, of course, here the changing of the use. So if we would do that, for example, I'll just quickly, we can just change this color, and then it will take on different colors. So we can also, if we would have something that we would really like, save it to a new color ramp, etc., etc. So there's a lot of freedom here that you can put to your advantage for designing a specific color ramp for your to your liking. Now, and as a final thing to point out, which is obvious, of course, is that now your the entry of this layer into the table of contents is now accompanied by the legenda of what we are looking at, which is very useful part of the functionality of the table of contents. And as you've seen me do earlier, you can change the individual classes, the individual categories that we made by double-clicking on the symbol and adjust it. Okay, so now on to the visualization of the raster data, so the data from the elevation model. Now, an important difference with raster data, as I've pointed out various occasions, is that the raster data is continuous data. So instead of being able to work with categories, classes, preset interpretations, which are of course also part of an interpretative process, but that's another matter. The visualization of raster data as a practice is in fact very active and very explicitly an act of interpretation, because you have no fixed boundaries between classes. So the parameters for the visualization of raster information is automatically based on, most of the times, a statistical analysis of the elevation data itself. So every step in the visualization of raster data is actually an active choice by which you manipulate what you are seeing, which is also an advantage, of course, because you can try to manipulate the raster data to really show elements that you want to bring out from your in this case elevation model, for example. Okay, so to engage with this, we can open the properties of this raster layer. And here we have then the layer properties window with a whole range of information and functions that we can set. But the important one for now is, of course, the symbology tab. And we'll go quickly through the options here. So we have here in the left part, we have different types of classification schemes. So we can use vector field unique values, classified, stretched, and discrete color. Now the most important ones here are classified and stretched. And stretched is already set as a default. Now very quickly, what would unique values do? Unique values would actually get, well, literally every unique elevation value from the raster and try to attribute colors to these unique values. Well, you can imagine that with a raster like this, there are so many unique values that this is going to be, an almost impossible undertaking. And indeed, if we select this, we reach immediately the default limitation for this this way of classifying. So we can forget about that. And another option would be to go for discrete color. And discrete color creates classes of values based on their color code, or their information code, I should say. And then it attributes colors to these classes in an automatic way. The result is something like this. So you get different colors for groups of values that are close together. But it's done randomly to a degree that you cannot control it. So this is again something that usually we do not use that often. So what we use often is the classified or the stretched option. Now the classified option allows you to create, indeed, as it say, classes. So what you do is you, for the total range of values, you can create classes based on different techniques like equal intervals or what's called Jenks, natural breaks, which is an algorithm that goes through the data and looks for a clustering of values. So you create, let's say, clusters of similar groups of altitude. And you can set, for example, the number of classes that you want. And then you get a map in which you turn the continuous data into discrete classes with clear boundaries, displaying different, let's say, ranges of elevation. And there are many different ways to go about this classification: equal interval, defined interval, quantiles, geometric interval, standard deviation. Can be very useful if you want to create either a simplified map or you want to do some uses for some kind of analysis to see, based on natural breaks, what the algorithm tells you, which are the most prominent units, for example, in your landscape. Now, the stretch, on the other hand, is the most common one used for information like digital elevation models, because the stretch is not making any classification in the sense of making groups of the values in your elevation model, but instead stretches a color ramp over the totality of your continuous altitude values, and allows you to manipulate a bit the way this color is stretched over your elevation value, so you can get the maximum of detail from your digital elevation model, and examine it using different types of stretch colors over it. Okay, so how does this work, this stretched visualization? We have here our color ramp, of course. We can choose for different color ramps, so let's choose a nice one. So if we do a different color ramp, you can see immediately the effect of using colors instead of gray, a grayscale. We can we see here the maximum and the minimum altitude value in our raster. We can also change the label. If we would change this, this directly refers to what we see here in the table of contents as the legend of the raster file. So if we want to show less decimals, for example, we can adjust that here. Well, we can set how we want to display background values if we have zeros in our cells, or some cells contain zeros, then we can say, well, display the value zero or any other value, 999, that may display a background value and give that some kind of color. We can use a hillshade effect. I will come back to this in a later video. And we can also say something about how no data should be displayed, so and totally empty cells. Okay, and then about the stretch, and this is actually the most important part of this this visualization technique. We have here the stretch type. And what we can do here is we can select which strategy is used to determine the minimum and maximum values of our raster, and the way the color ramp is stretched over these minimum and maximum values. So the default is percent clip, and it means that the assumption is there that the higher and so that the majority of values fall within a limit, an upper and a lower limit, and that the extremes on either the lower or the higher end are less interesting. And so your color ramp is stretched between everything that falls within these the majority, so to say. So the extreme ends are clipped from the data set. Another way to do this is standard deviations, and then you can just say I want a specific number of standard deviations from the mean value of my roster and use that as the minimum and maximum to stretch my color ramp in between. And you can see that this is immediately gives a very different result. And this is exactly what I mean with how roster visualization is already an act of analysis and interpretation. Now, what is interesting here is to look at the histogram and how that changes. Because if we would revert back to percent clip and click on this histogram button, wait, let's apply it first and we click on the histogram button. What we can see here is actually the frequency distribution of the values in our roster. So what we see here is the minimum of 7.62, the maximum of 14.75, a mean of 9.11 and standard deviation of 0.58. And that reflects indeed that those are the metrics describing this curve of data that you can see here. So indeed from seven roughly to 14 and a bit. And a mean that must be indeed around 9. So you can see here already that even now with this percent clip in which the maximum and minimum ranges are clipped, we can see that there's enormous concentration of values on a very short range. And that means that the part of the color ramp covering this spectrum actually with very few colors or relatively few colors covers a lot of variation in data, whereas the variation in this area is covered by a huge range of colors, so it's very dominant in the picture, whereas all the variation in this very small spectrum is likely to be much less dominant in the visualization. Now, if we go back to the standard deviations we apply and we go for the histograms, you can see what happens. So now the data is of course the same. We still see the actual frequency distribution, but because the values are now stretched between 2.5 standard deviation from the mean on both sides, and where they are accessing it, they are all just added to one single group of values. You can see here that indeed now all the details get a lot more part of the color ramp, so are expressed in more detail. Now, this is a good preparation to what then, for example, histogram equalize would do. And if we select that and we click on the histogram, let's apply first. In this case, this is actually not very useful. But if we then select the histogram, you can see that something else happened. So what a histogram equalize does is it makes sure that the number of values is spread evenly over the color range. So all these central frequencies that contain a high number of values, of actual cell values, are now given much more space in the histogram and therefore also in the color ramp. In this case, it's not really helping because it actually now coincides with very little variation in the color ramp, and we lose a lot of detail because it's now pressed into the far ends. So the important thing to take away from this is that what we are actually doing with the stretch actions is we are trying to increase contrast in the areas where we think it is useful and interesting to increase it. And it's very dependent on the information in the raster itself what approach is the best one. I will show a final one so you can we can go for something called minimum maximum. And here we can now, for example, and if I apply that, we get this result. So now everything is taken into account, all our data. But what we can do is now we can edit the high and the low values. So let's say that given the histogram, we see that, well, actually above 12 and maybe even above 10, or maybe above 11, the information is not that dense anymore, and we may just not be happy to visualize that, because these may be larger elements in the terrain, like some brushes, for example, that are still in the data model, or a ramp in our elevation model. And we can try to we would not be interested in that information. So what we could do here, say for example, we want a maximum of 11 in our color ramp, and maybe we want a minimum of 8. And now we reduce the actual data, which is not visible actually in the histogram, but reduced the range of values over which the color ramp is now stretched. So that means much more color for much more subtle variations in altitude. And this can be very interesting if you're looking for very small variations in a small subrange of values in the raster. And if we accept that, we can see that this is interesting. We see a lot of things happening now in this field. We see here lines that are not running in the current orientation of the field. It may have something to do with old field divisions and maybe old plowing directions. We see here something of a line running diagonally that actually coincides with this feature here, more or less, that has been identified as a water filled ditch. So maybe this is an expression of an old ditch that still has some effect in the altitude values of this elevation model. Okay, and then a final thing to note is that indeed here this is a ramp, and this is part of the most elevated part of the terrain that we capture in this digital elevation model. We see here, we have here indeed a pixel value of 14.63 meters above sea level. Just to show what we actually did, if we would revert back to the minimum maximum, let's just go back to the default minimum maximum, in which all values are taken into account, even the highest, we can see that there's a lot of variation. So actually a large part of the color ramp is used to express the elevation differences in this ramp, whereas you can see that only the lowest part of the color ramp, so these light green to blue values or colors, I mean, are used to visualize the rest. And that kind of, well, it still is quite okay, to be honest. But you may imagine that when it comes to increasing contrast, it also has something to do with the fact that this is a very a color ramp with very many different colors involved. So if I would choose a simpler, this effect is going to be clearer. So if I would just choose this one, you can see that the expression of differences here is will be much less visible. Whereas on the other hand, if I would again create this manually limited maximum and minimum values, and I would apply this, I'm already able to see much more variation, because everything we have here now is part of a single class. So it's actually everything higher than 11 has the same color. And if we go back to our color ramp, you can see that this is actually the color white, which is the highest color value in this color ramp. Okay, and then to finish the options here in the raster symbology, there is here the possibility to apply gamma stretch, which has something to do with increasing contrast for the mid-range values, which is again something that you can play with to increase contrast and maybe create a little bit better visualization, if you like. Okay, then there's a third element of this visualization demonstration. I will label these finds. So what we have here are these finds. If we would double click on the symbol, We can see that again, we go quickly into the symbol selector window and we can change the actual symbols that we want to use for the indication of these finds. If we go for the properties and we go to the symbology tab, we can here set also things like rotation and size. We can set symbol levels. So that means on what level, what scale level will we be able to see a symbol drawn in a specific way. So you can do that to create maps that are on various scales visualized differently for optimal clarity. And we can also, of course, make categories based on the information in the attribute table and so on and so forth. But we've seen it already, so I will we'll leave it at this. And what we now want to change for this layer is to set labels. Now, we can go to the labels tab for that. We have to turn this on, so label features in this layer. We want to label all the features in the same way. An obvious thing we would be possibly be interested in is to label these finds with the find numbers. We can also define classes of features, for example, based on information in the attribute table, and then use different labeling strategies for them. But we want now to label all the features in the same way. We will use the information from, the number. We can also use an expression if we want to create a label by concatenating information from various columns, for example. For now, we'll just leave it at the column. And then there's a range of options to set. So we can, of course, set the text symbol, so the font type, the size, some basic properties like colors, bold, etc. And then there are some things like placement properties in which we can determine where we want the label to be visualized with reference to the point. So do we want it on the top right corner, to the left, or what have you? And we can also set some parameters when it comes to conflict detection, because you can imagine it if you have a lot of labels in your map. You may have overlapping labels. Now, do you want that? Do you want overlapping labels to be removed, or at least one of them? And then you can say, well, in case there's overlap, I want to give more weight to the labels of this layer. So the labels of the other layers are the ones that will be removed, and so on and so forth. So you can set a whole lot of things for this labeling, the placement properties, so you create a well-readable map. That's all for you just to take away. I will now, as a demonstration of labeling, just hit OK. And indeed, you can see here that we now have our find numbers as labels for our find locations. Okay, so with this, I've come to the end of the demonstration of how to visualize your data using vector data with polygons, using a raster layer, and working with color ramps, and then finally labeling a vector layer with points. Now, to finish this first screencast, I want to elaborate a little bit on two things. First of all, how to make a quick map. And second of all, I want to say a thing or two about project data management. Okay, to start with making a map. As I mentioned in the start, where I explained the interface of ArcMap, I already mentioned this button, which we can use to switch to layout view. Now, this is quite convenient. So in the same area and in exactly the same interface as in which we have been working, we can now simply switch to layout view, and what we are presented with is a sheet layout. So the area that you see here indicated now is actually the canvas of our sheet. So this is based on an A4 paper, and we have here our layout toolbar that we can use to manipulate our layout. Now, there are a couple of things which are important here. First of all, what we are now looking at is one data frame. So this is a data frame that's actually covering all the data that we have here. And all these layers are present in the data frame. Now, there's a direct connection, of course, between the elements in the table of contents and that in the layer frame. So we can, if we switch off something in the table of contents, the information will also be not visible in the data frame. So we can set the elements that we want to visualize in our map by turning on and off these different elements. Now, we can also change the way the data frame is being stretched over our map sheet. So we can, of course, do something like fit to margins, and then we get the maximum extent of the data frame on our printable sheet, respecting the margins of the paper page itself. Now, another important thing to notice here is that there are two ways we can now navigate, because we can navigate now if we use in this layout view the mouse button and the panning. By pressing down the mouse button, we are actually moving our sheet. So we're not moving in and out to our actual data anymore. So that will, the visualization of that will not change. The labels and the symbols will all stay similarly sized, and we just go through our the information. We are just going through the map sheet, and these elements here on the layout toolbar are doing exactly the same. So we are zooming in on our paper sheet. We are panning, we are zooming to the whole page, and we have fixed zoom in and out, and here we see zoom 2%. So this is important to know, because the standard navigation tools are not anymore navigating us through the actual data anymore. Now, it is of course possible to navigate through your data, but then we have to make sure that we select the navigation tools that refer to the map itself. So we select the data frame, and then we can use the zoom in button, and then we can actually zoom in onto our data. And now the extent of the data that we are displaying on our map is actually changing. And the same goes for the panning, and the same goes now for the zooming to the full extent, of course, which is still based on the Verharding shapefile. So this is how we can deal with that. Now, another important thing to note is that this is a portrait visualization. So this is a portrait view on our data, and we may want to switch the sheet to a landscape. So we just want it to rotate 90 degrees so we can display our information a bit more efficiently. Now, we can do this by going to File, Page and Print Setup, and then we can select here in the paper settings, Orientation Landscape instead of Portrait. Click OK, and now we have a landscape view. Of course, now it is we should do the distribution again. So we distribute, we fit to margins, and we zoom in onto the data that is of main interest, because we just want to create a map of the archaeological trial trenches that have been dug here. So that's how you change the orientation of your paper sheet. Okay, now let's finish this map by adding a map components like a scale bar, a north arrow, and the legend. We can do this by going to Insert. Here we have the elements that I was talking about. So let's just start with adding a scale bar. Now, there are various options here for selecting a scale bar to your liking. It all depends. Also, this is on a matter of design and taste. But, well, let's just select a simple one. We can adjust its properties. We can also do that later. Let's just add it to the map. And here it is. So now we have a scale bar. Because of the enthusiastic colors of the age and data, it is not everywhere as well visible. if we want to adjust the scale bar now, we can double click on it and we can make change here some settings. I will go into more detail about that in a later video, but just so we have a bit of a more clear scale bar on a location where I like it. I want it to be displayed at the bottom of the screen. I will now add a white background with a bit of a margin around it, so the scale bar is much better visible. So there it is. And now I can place it here. I can make it a bit smaller or larger, and what you can see is that it automatically adjusts the values that are shown. So it automatically adjusts the segments of the scale bar. So I like it like this. Now then I want to insert a north arrow. Again, a whole set of north arrow styles you can choose from, and of course it's possible to create your own north arrows or to download images that you can use as a north arrow. I will select the simple one, hit OK, and here we have a north arrow. And then finally I want to insert a legend. We click on legend. Now there's a bit more to legends, of course. What we can do here now, first of all, is to determine what we want explained in our legend. So what classification, what data do we want to indicate, what symbols do we want to have explained. Something that we could that may possibly be the most interesting here is the actual feature interpretation. So if we only want, so here we see the map layers and here we see the legend items, and we can switch from, we can add from the map layers items to our legend, but we can also remove them by clicking this left arrow here. So if I just remove the layers that we do not want to be explained in our legend and just leave spore art layer 1, we want the number of columns in our legend. We click next. We can set a legend title, title font properties, etc. Title justification. Again, we can set a border and a background. Well, we saw that the background is actually quite useful here, so let's do that. The gap is automatically set to 10, so that's fine. And then we could actually change the size and the shape of the symbol patch. But for now, I'm totally happy with these settings, and we click next. And now we can set spacing between the parts. So that means the amount of space that is present between all the various groups and titles and items in your legend. But we'll leave it as it is and we'll hit OK. And now we have our legend. Now, we can resize this legend, and of course it's a bit too big, so we can resize this easily to so that it fits our map. Now, it's in this case unavoidable that it's going to overlay some of our information. So I will now select the data frame again and move the content a little bit so it will not be overlapping. And yeah, I think this is excellent. Okay. I think this is still possible. Okay, because otherwise we have no more elevation model on our map, so I still want that. And then finally, it's good to know that if you double click the legend, we can again change the visualization of our data, of the information in our legend. We can also set that we want it to be organized in different columns. So we get, let's say, for example, 2 columns, then we get the information displayed like this. We can then maybe possibly make it a bit bigger, and so on and so forth. So this is how you can work with making a very quick illustration. And then finally, if you are happy with your map, we can just export it as an image. And this is how you do that. So we can go to the file menu again. We click on export map. Here we can select various file formats. In this case, I just want to create a JPEG. And I want this to have a name. Well, I'm fine with project.jpg actually. The location is already in our the data set that we've been working with so far. We can set resolution width height. And then we have some settings when it comes to the file type that we chose. But I'm fine with this. I click save. And if we then go to the data set and search for the project.jpg, we can see it here. And indeed, we created now this fine map based on the layout view, such as we designed it in ArcGIS. Okay, and then to finish off with a few things about project data management. In order to demonstrate the first and most important principle of how to deal with JS projects, I will save this this map document. So if I do that, I already did it, but I will just choose save as and save, give it a name, and it will get an .mxd file extension, which is an ArcMap document. And I will hit save, and yes, I want to overwrite in this case. Now the important thing here is that if I go to the folder with this data where I made this this file now, we see here project.mxd, and this is actually a 48 kilobyte, a 480 kilobyte file. So this is a very small file. Now why is this file so small with all this data in our project? It is because the data is actually not stored in the file. So this is different as what you may be used to with, let's for example, Microsoft Office documents, in which the data is actually stored in the file itself. And ArcGIS MXD file is just a reference to externally stored data. So the MXD stores the reference, so you can find it stores the path, so you can find this data in this or that location. It stores the visualizations, it stores selections, it stores the designed layout for your map. So these are all settings and parameters that it stores, but it doesn't store the actual data. And that is important because if you would, for example, want to share your project with someone and just send him the .mxd file, obviously you're going to see an empty map and ArcGIS telling you that it can't find the source data and therefore cannot display the data in the way that you set the project and save the project. So this is important to understand that you always need to keep things together, and the MXD is just a set of definitions. Now, directly following from that is the second point to make, which is important. And this is because we have references to the location of the source files stored in the MXD. And maybe you already feel where this is going to. If you would change the location of the source files, even if you would still keep them together, if you change the location relative to the MXD document, you are going to have a problem because it won't be able to find it. Now, a way to deal with this is to go to File, and we go to the Map Document Properties. And in the Map Document Properties, we can see here at the lower end of the Properties window, we can see here Path Names, and then we can hit this tick box and say Store Relative Path Names to the Data Sources. Now, what this does is instead of going for a fixed path, such as you can see here, so it will go to C and then look for a folder structure and then finally the location of the file, it will start looking at the location where the MXD file is located. So the locations of these data will now be stored relative to the MXD. So now if you would, for example, change you would replace all your project files onto a different hard disk or a different folder, so the drive letter would change or the folder structure would change. It as long as you keep all these files together, this is not a problem. In the scenario that I mentioned earlier, where you would put your layers in a different file relative to the MXD file, then you will still have this problem, because then you've also changed the relative path. But as long as you keep stuff together and store relative path names to your data sources, you are all right. Okay, and then the final thing to say about this, so I will now accept this, but just know that it is only from this point onwards that it will store relative path names. So when I add a new layer now to my file, to my MXD file, there's a relative path names, but the current layers are absolute. So if I want everything to be relative, I have to add everything again. And then the final thing to say about it, going back to the organization of data on your hard disk, this is all for the user itself. It's something you have to decide for yourself, but it is clear that GIS data, if you have big projects, will really benefit with a clearly structured folder organization. If only because GIS files can exist in many different individual actual files on your hard disk. So this SporArt layer 1 file that I created, the shape file, that is looking like a single item in our R catalog, so here it is in fact on your hard disk a collection of files with different file extensions. And this is because every individual file covers a different type of functionality. So we have, for example, the DBF, in which the attribute data is stored. We have the .prg, in which projection data is stored. We have the .shp, in which the geometries are actually stored, and so on and so forth. So it is important to keep this together. That's one thing. So if you would move these files around, make sure you get them all together. But you can imagine also that if you have a lot of shape files, then you will have an enormous list of files here. So you can benefit from a good folder structure, which can then be organized to data types or to different thematic sources, data sources. Or you can say, well, this, yeah, I will have a folder for topography, I have a folder for archaeology, I will have a folder for elevation data and derivatives, and so on and so forth. And it is good if you would create that beforehand. Use maybe a standardized or default organization, and then create your project. Make sure it stores relative path names, and then you can kind of use this setup every time and again. You will get used to it. You will improve it, and that will really work beneficial for your project organization, and to keep things tidy and easy to oversee. Okay, so with this final remarks on data project data management, we've come to the end of this first screencast. And I thank you for listening and watching.